I would like to get down to the discussion that you started having with me in that email, where you laid out the numbers, and I mean you've touched on it already, but what are we looking at in terms of the time that it will take to infect the overwhelming majority or plurality of people in any country that does not take proper precautions? I mean, how fast is this thing going to spread?
Well, it seems to be that if not controlled, then the rate of increase of cases is about 30% a day. That's the current rate in Britain. It was the rate in Italy before they did the lockdown. So if you're not doing anything to keep people apart and to prevent people just leading normal lives, then it's 30% a day. And I mean, of course, the classic exponential is the wise courtier of the king who says, you know, I want to, instead of giving me a warehouse full of rice, you give me one grain on the first square of a chessboard and two grains on the second and so on. And by the end of it, all you've got is about as much rice as will fill the universe.
Doubling. So 30%
a 30% rise per day. Yeah.
That means 100% increase, a doubling every 3 days. Because it's 30% plus 30% of 30% plus...
Yeah, it comes about 3 days is the doubling time.
Yeah.
So Britain can still be complacent. They had about 400 cases then three days ago. Now they've got 800 cases. Oh, there's nothing to worry about then. It's just a few hundred cases. But it's exactly like global warming and carbon dioxide levels.
Can you put together for me a kind of back of the envelope calculation, literally or in your head? How long will it take until the entire population at the rate of doubling every 3 days? How long would it take until the entire population of England has that?
I can do it in my head. Say you've got 1,000 cases as your start off, and nothing is done. 3 days, you've got 2,000. So it's a chessboard problem. Yes. It's in 3 days, you've got 1,000, you're going to 2,000, 4, 8, 16, 32, 256, 512. So a million is 2 to the 10, isn't it?
Yes, 2 to the 10 is a bit over a million.
If you then, and of course the next million is just the next point on the curve. So if you're thinking about the entire population, that's 2, 4, 8, 16, that's 10 to 15. And so 15 lots of 3 days, that's 45 days. So in 45 days, the entire population of Britain will have the bug.
We're not starting with one case, we're starting with approximately 1,000 cases. So do you have to take, it may be shorter, and there's a little bit of a flaw in the mathematics in that you can't reinfect infected people. So the growth rate of 30% every 3 days will probably, or excuse me, doubling every 3 days will probably fall off when you don't have that many people more to infect, you know.
Yes, but roughly speaking, it's 45 days, because, you know, month and a half, you can go from having a handful of cases to having everybody in the country with a deadly disease, which is going to kill 1, 2, 3, or 4% of them, which it doesn't sound a lot, but if 4% of 60 million is a couple of million. And so you're dealing with, if you don't take any action, million, you know, of the order of millions, 1, 2, 3, 4 million people in an advanced European country will be dead. And a country can't stand that. I mean, you can't, from going from nothing, going from, oh, let's all eat, drink, and be merry, to suddenly a million dead. It's more than the Black Death.
Excuse me for the bad pun, but it's not eat, drink, and be merry. It's eat, drink, and be buried.
Yes, well, you won't even be buried because there's too many people dying to be buried. That's it's like the great
mass graves,
just like you had with the Black Death.
Yeah.
So it complete collapse of society, and that's going to happen, and it's going to happen soon. And that's the frightening thing, is that it inevitably is going to happen because of this exponential growth rate, and so you have to accept that that is happening and is going to happen. And Italy's accepted it and has taken action and has brought that growth rate at least down to 14%, which is means that instead of a 3-day, you're getting seven days doubling time. But in that time, it's going right down the way that in Korea it's gone down, to the point where you're getting a less than 1-to-1 reinfection. Once each person infects less than one other person, then the total number of cases goes down, and you're really sort of saved. And again, it's a bit like it's exactly like CO2 in the atmosphere. You do air capture, and you start bringing it down, even if you haven't got rid of it. If you're bringing it down, you're gaining, you're winning. And this is what is happening once you get the reinfection rate down to less than one per person.
I'm glad you touch on climate change, or you're making a comparison, an analogy with carbon dioxide removal. I wanted to segue towards the climate connection, because most people don't see any connection between the pandemic and climate change, where in fact there's a strong connection in that I for 10 years have been giving presentations where I occasionally will present that slide, which shows 10 or so infectious diseases whose range spread and whose vectors spread more prolifically, would spread because of climate change. Because, for instance, the West Nile virus, it was introduced to the United States, but it was introduced at a time when winters were not getting as cold, not killing as many of the mosquitoes, the ticks, what the vectors. So this is no ordinary pandemic, mind you, or no ordinary epidemic. This is one where there's good reason to believe that it may have been an engineered strain of this virus, because, as has been pointed out, it's kind of dropped out of the conversation to a good extent, I believe, but to a bad extent. Wuhan is where the Chinese have their germ warfare research lab, and according to my connection to the US intelligence community, the United States has a germ warfare lab with the knowledge and understanding and acceptance of the Chinese government. I have no idea how that one got worked out, but we, America, have a germ warfare lab in Wuhan.
Gosh. Yeah. Well, that's, one's jaw drops, because in theory, biological warfare was outlawed by UN agreement, but everybody, or at least all the militaristic nations in the world, kept their research labs. And these labs are terribly badly run. And, well, there's a fort in Maryland, is it Dedrick or Cedric? Fort Dedrick in Maryland, which has just been, and the conspiracy theory, one of the conspiracy theories about this virus, is that this facility in Maryland was closed in December. It had been threatened with closure many times because there'd been leaks of deadly agents from this, from obviously a slapdash place. I think about a leak per year, there's usually at least one leak of some deadly agent out of this lab. So the lab was finally closed down, and or it's been closed down as of December. But there was an athletic competition that was held in Wuhan in December, where there were three of the people from that lab went to that athletic competition, and they could have, if there had been a leak of a virus from that lab, they could have taken that to China. I mean, so it could have originated actually from the US, far from being a foreign virus, a deadly foreign virus, which we must fight. It could be a US virus, and could easily be. We will never know, because anybody who reveals that is obviously going to be killed by the CIA or whoever. You know, this is something where the embarrassment of admitting that you are the source of this deadly infection would be fatal. It would be fatal to your whole plan of controlling the world.
Yeah. Oh my God. What have we done?
Because it seems to have been configured to be particularly deadly to humans. I mean, there's some parts of the DNA structure that look as if they were inserted or engineered with an engineering reason.
Yes, and the way I understand some of that we will never know stuff that came out early on. There was an email that I got that was distributed to a short list of maybe a dozen people from this source I have in the intelligence community, where someone on the list said, "I'm glad I took this screenshot early in the day, because when I clicked on the link again, it was gone. It was censored." And it was an article that implied or stated that the source was an accident in one of the germ warfare labs. And when you take a look, the fact that this virus is spread by bats, okay, if one was going to try to figure out how to create a delivery system for a lethal virus, the bat would be a very good vector. It's a mammal. It flies around at night, undetectable. And it, with every flap of the wings, I'm presuming it can shed this virus into the surrounding atmosphere. So it's like a perfect delivery system in certain ways. And they've said, not speculated, I think they've said that it got started in Wuhan from bats that were being either eaten in a market that's whatever the story was, the vector for transmission seems to have been bats. And as you say, as I've just learned from you, there are parts of the DNA that look like they were inserted.
Well, I mean, the possible villains are the Chinese and the Americans. And the Chinese case, it would be, one theory is that they were actually working on an antidote to the SARS virus, and that this virus was an intermediate step, and it escaped from the lab. That's one theory. That a vicious theory would be that it was being deliberately engineered by China to be released in an American city. If you did to, say, well, Seattle has had a bad time, but say Washington or New York or San Francisco, you release it in the middle of that city, then you'd have a Wuhan situation in a major American city. It would be completely disastrous. So that's the malevolent Chinese theory. And then the accidental American theory is this one about Fort Dedrick in Maryland being closed down and the staff carrying away the virus on their clothes and taking it to Wuhan by accident, because that was where they had this sort of military games. It was a games for people working in military labs, so sort of a ghastly kind of satanic games, and America, some Americans took part.
There is one other alternative. If, as has been told me, the United States has a germ warfare, biological warfare lab, they have more than one around outside of China in that area, and they have one in Wuhan. It could have been something that the United States was developing to release in a city in China like Wuhan. Perhaps. Anyway, well, we're speculating, but it's kind of interesting, the possibilities. And again, the piece that you just gave me, the piece of the puzzle, is that I'd love to see the headline or the research that says that if you look at the DNA of the RNA of the virus, that there are parts that look like they were inserted.
Yes, I can send you that. It was actually an article by Chinese scientists that was published in a Chinese scientific journal and was then withdrawn. I can send you the reference, not to the paper in Chinese, but to the people who have read that paper before it was withdrawn.
And I'm wondering if the authors, co-authors of the article, are still alive, still have their freedom.
Yeah.
As you know, there were 8 doctors in Wuhan who started saying this is lethal, and they started high profiling their concerns that we've got something here that is got the capability of being a pandemic. And the Chinese government came in and said, stop telling these vicious lies. And later they died. These were doctors who were treating patients. It's a horrible situation.